So we all know that SpaceX's Starship is making great progress at Boca Chica, and all of you viewers understand why Starship is so extremely important for the future of mankind. However, there is a growing trend of resistance towards spaceflight, and many people seem to be outright triggered by Starship or human space exploration in general. So what's behind this worrying trend?
Then, Russia won't talk about their planned reusable Amur rocket anymore. We wonder why. In other news, asteroid samples seem to be leaking from Osiris-Rex. Axiom Space is finalizing their first commercial mission to the ISS. And SpaceX's valuation is continuing to rise. A lot to talk about as always, so stay tuned.
So let's start with the latest developments at Boca Chica, because there's not one single day where nothing interesting is happening there. SN8 is standing on the launch pad A, the nose cone still attached to the crane, with preparations ongoing for the legendary 15-kilometer test flight. SN9 is still waiting to get the rear body flaps installed, while SN10 is getting a new part, namely the aft section. SN10 still being located in the mid bay. Lots of ring parts are lying around, waiting to be installed into SN10 and even SN11. Here we can see a clearer shot of an SN11 part, namely the common dome. The Super Heavy launch pad is still looking as last week, probably work will only continue after the SN8 hop. But it appears that the high bay is finished now, and we sincerely hope that stacking of the Super Heavy will finally begin soon. So, long story short, everyone is waiting for the SN8 hop, which will be super important, because without the atmospheric re-entry of Starship, the whole Starship project cannot work. It is therefore absolutely crucial that atmospheric re-entry works. But we are very sure that it will work, because SpaceX is now much more careful with its approach than only a year ago. Of course, Elon still is not satisfied. It could go faster for his taste, but if we compare this progress to the likes of Boeing and Lockheed, we'd say the progress is absolutely insane. And you know, and we know, that Starship is the single most important space vehicle of humanity, which will bring down costs of human spaceflight by factors of tens of thousands, thus enabling us to live on the Moon and Mars and advance the human species to the final frontier.
Space fans like you and us, of course, know this is awesome and how important it is for humanity to become a multi-planetary species, because there are just so many possibilities on how we could go extinct here on Earth. Super volcanoes, giant asteroid impact, killer virus, gamma ray burst, runaway greenhouse effect. The list is pretty long. Therefore, if we live on the Moon, Mars, and later other bodies in the solar system, humanity will endure, no matter what will happen on Earth. Considering that consciousness is a pretty neat thing, you know, being capable of seeing and understanding the universe is pretty nice. So preserving that should be a total no-brainer. But unfortunately, there's a growing trend of people who oppose exactly that. A large number of people really don't understand why space exploration is so important. And you can see such people just everywhere, commenting like berserks on Twitter, or even here in the YouTube comment section, and getting triggered by positive news on Starship. You can read highly intelligent tweets like this one here, or this one here. This one here is also awesome. Or that one, or also this one here. This is just a small excerpt, but you get the idea. Many people are opposed to spaceflight. So where does this come from? What is the real reason behind this?
Well, this here certainly plays a role. The brutal reality of the IQ bell curve. 16% of people, so every sixth person has an IQ below 85. Every sixth person. And those people do use Twitter and YouTube, oh yes. But it would be too easy to explain this phenomenon only with IQ. Because we've met many intelligent and well-educated people who also share the belief that humanity should fix their problems here on Earth first. So it cannot be only the IQ, neither can it be only attributed to the level of education. So what is it then? Well, we'd say it basically comes down to a person's view on technology. Do you see the advancement of human technology as something positive or something negative? Well, luckily most people would agree that technology brings more benefits than downsides. For most of human history, the average life expectancy was between 20 and 30 years of age. In the Stone Age, you would die from an infection or food shortage or predation. Technology has eliminated all these threats, so that the average life expectancy has more than tripled since then.
Technology helps us to live a longer and healthier life. Yet, space exploration technology, many people think, does not seem to affect us here on Earth. Thus, it is a waste of resources. We should first be solving the problems here on Earth, right? Well, turns out that many of the technologies we take for granted have been developed directly or indirectly as a result of space exploration technology. Be it the cochlear implant, cardiac pacemakers, rescue blankets, insulating foam, or even CMOS sensors, which everyone uses in their smartphones.
Without space exploration, we wouldn't have many technologies which we take for granted and which we use on a daily basis. That is something which is not obvious, thus even many smart people with good education simply don't know this. It is therefore very important to spread this knowledge so that space exploration technology is not viewed so disfavorably anymore by the general population. The more this knowledge spreads, the more people will be able to understand why spreading humanity to the stars is so important. It is not to have the rich fleeing the planet, as depicted, for example, in the movie Elysium, and as some stupid mainstream media headlines would want to make you believe. Nay, but it is to save humanity from certain extinction. And please consider subscribing to our channel, because we are brutally honest and we will never back down from even sensitive or political topics. And of course, we'll always continue to make fun of people triggered by space exploration. Oh, and as a subscriber, you can even vote on topics for our Wednesday videos on our YouTube homepage. Thank you very much.
Okay, we had to talk about the opposition to space exploration. But meanwhile, the Russian space agency Roscosmos doesn't want to talk so much about their reusable Amur rocket anymore. We talked about Roscosmos' plans to build a reusable rocket, which looks strangely similar to the Falcon 9. In this video here. But now apparently, Roscosmos wants to be more secretive because the public sentiment might harm the development of this reusable rocket, which they plan to be finished by 2026. We wonder why. Did people notice that this is a blatant design copy of SpaceX's Falcon 9? Or was it the fact that Roscosmos made fun of SpaceX's reusable rockets since 10 years ago? And now suddenly, they made a 180-degree turn and want to build their own reusable rockets. We don't know the real reason for sure. We only know that this is really hilarious. Let's see what will happen in 2026, when SpaceX will have built the first moon colony with Starship and is probably already preparing for the first manned Mars missions. Let's see even who will be interested in the Russian Amur rocket. Last Saturday, we already talked about NASA's Osiris-Rex mission and how cool it is that the touchdown on asteroid Bennu went so smoothly. And now it turns out that Osiris-Rex has collected too much material, thus the lid of the sampling head couldn't close properly, which now leads to soil samples from Bennu leaking out of the sampling mechanism. This has now prompted NASA to change their plans and store the samples in a canister inside the spacecraft as fast as possible, foregoing a planned maneuver which would have taken place before this. So it seems that we don't have to worry, because the about 2 kilograms of collected samples will be safely returned back to Earth in 2023.
Then Axiom Space is finalizing the first commercial mission to the ISS with Crew Dragon, currently scheduled for late 2021. That mission is expected to feature 3 customers along with 1 Axiom astronaut, Michael Lopez Alegria, a former NASA astronaut. Axiom has not disclosed who the other astronauts are, although there are rumors floating around that one of them could indeed be Tom Cruise. Because we remember that in May this year, it had been announced that Tom Cruise would make the first action movie produced in space. Now, while 7 people have already flown to the ISS as space tourists, all took advantage of available seats on Russian Soyuz missions funded by the Russian government space agency Roscosmos. So the Axiom mission will be the first fully private commercial mission to space. But Axiom Space is actually already planning further ahead. They want to build some commercial modules and have them attached to the ISS, which will then form the core of a commercial space station that will detach from the ISS when it will be retired, which is currently planned for around 2028 to 2030.
With the advancements of Starlink and Starship, the valuation of SpaceX is of course also bound to increase, much to the dismay of anti-space exploration zealots. Even investment bank Morgan Stanley is taking notice, raising its space case enterprise value of SpaceX from $52 billion to $101 billion. They said, quote, "The pieces are coming together for SpaceX to create an economic and technological flywheel." Wow, not bad, Morgan Stanley, not bad. That's what we and others had already been saying for years. But apparently now, even Wall Street is recognizing that SpaceX is poised to become one of the biggest companies on this planet. And by 2030, SpaceX will certainly be among the biggest companies on this planet. The other one being most certainly Tesla. So investing into SpaceX, of course, would be nice, which we can hopefully do soon in the form of Starlink. When Starlink goes IPO, it is a total no-brainer to buy as many Starlink shares as possible. And Tesla shareholders might have the privilege to buy some Starlink shares before all the others, as some rumors floating around have suggested. And we want to thank everyone who participated in our live stream from yesterday. It was a really nice experience for us. Thanks a lot.
It was amazing, really, thanks.
And now we are considering doing it more often, maybe once per month. Yeah. Let us know what you think in the comment section.
And despite all those naysayers who don't like space exploration, SpaceX is advancing and is building the Moon Starship, about which we talked in last week's video. So then, thanks as always for watching the JS Space Report, and as always, on to the future. Yeah.
Yetza. And now we want to thank everyone who participated in the live stream.
Mm-hmm.
Space Report, what did we do? Ah, the Moon Starship.